good morning again.
Good morning.
Good to see everyone this morning. Also, again, let's see here, Children's Church this morning, Brent and Johnson has that. So 12 and under, invite you to go over for that. And then while they're going over for Children's Church, if you want to go ahead and mark in your hymnals, number 358, we'll be using that as our hymn of invitation this morning. It's always a privilege for me to share God's word with you. Again, if you're visiting, we have a few, and it's good to have you with us this morning, and certainly encourage you to come back anytime you can. If you're looking for a church home, we'd like to invite you to consider Locust Grove. A few observations this week. If you watch the news, keep up with the news at all, or any TV, you know you're this day and time, you're liable to hear anything said. We see a lot of emphasis is being put on the statements people have made in the past months and all the controversy stirred up about that. And, of course, we're used to that as well. You're liable to hear it while you're out shopping or doing your daily routine at work. We're accustomed to hearing different varying opinions. A couple of funny things happened over the course of the weekend thus far. The first one happened Friday night, and this has to do with our words and our actions. We were at the ball game up in Lexington, baseball game, and they did the God Bless America at the fourth inning stretch, which I didn't know there was such a thing, but that was okay. But the seventh inning stretch, they had Ralph Stanley singing I'll Fly Away. That was pretty neat. It's bluegrass. There were several church groups there, and I thought, well, maybe they're doing that as kind of a little respect toward church groups. Well, the group of people, two different groups of people sat in the row in front of us, they had partaken all night long. Of course, it was a hot night, and we drank a lot of lemonade. Their lemonade was not the same color as mine. And I'll just say they were rather happy people. That's a good part. Well, when Ralph Stanley came on and the banjo started picking, I was amazed at how well these happy people knew every word to I'll Fly Away. And they were rather excited about the song. They were clapping and stomping and hollering yee-haw. And I thought, man, I hope you get that excited in church, but I hope you don't have to get that happy to go to church. And that's exactly how it was. Kind of funny how the people reacted. The people sang, and I expected the church groups. I was tapping my foot. I enjoyed it. It was a nice break. But I thought, what if we got that excited about singing about the praises of going to heaven someday? What a great example it would be as a Christian, how we could model ourselves after Christ. Well, let's turn the page over to Saturday. I got up yesterday morning, got several things done, and was getting preparations to come up to church and finish up sermons and PowerPoints, and I thought, well, I'll go over and fill the truck up. And so I pulled into Kroger, and if you ever fuel at Kroger, I don't know why they don't put arrows on those fuel lanes, because it's always just a gom of people. You know how it is. Well, there was this one gentleman trying to back, which, you know, was a mistake. He was trying to back into a gas pump. And there was another gentleman and a lady in another vehicle that did not like the fact that he was trying to back into that gasoline pump, and they let him know rather loudly. He blew the horn, and I'm not just talking about tap, tap. He stayed on the horn, him and her both screaming at the top of their lungs, this poor guy trying to back his car into the fuel pump. And I thought, man, just let him back up, and it's all over. So I just pulled over and just said, I'm resigned. I know that if I go to Kroger on Saturday to get fuel, I'm late. So I'm just pulling over there, sitting and waiting. And sure enough, about the time that I get into a pump, this guy that made all the noise and expressed his displeasure, he pulls into the pump opposite side facing me, and he gets out, and he's a big man. And he's got a shirt on, and it says, so-and-so church, deacon, dad. I went, really? I said, I hope you don't wear that shirt out public too often and act like that. But that's what we see. I mean, I realize we get a little aggravated at the way people act out in public, and they do things that we don't approve of. Of course, we never do that, right? We never make a mistake. But to do that and not have no more thought about that we are a Christian than that people watch us, and to act that way over, really, honestly, if we think about it, what would it, does it take? 5 seconds to back a car up 20 feet if you're taking your time, wanting to make sure you don't hit the pump? Are we so busy that 5 seconds makes a difference in our lives to where we lose our Christianity or our bearing as a Christian and really make a fool of ourselves over someone trying to do that? And then display that on our shirt that I'm a Christian acting like a fool. You know, what we say and what we do is very important. And that's this morning's sermon, is be careful about our actions and our words. And we have to do that. And I know that we know that, but there are times in life, when life goes on, that just like that guy, and I'm not saying he wasn't a good guy. Don't get me wrong. But what I'm saying, I'm using him as an example, he could be any of us, that we could just for a few seconds lose our bearing. And people, at that point is when people are going to look at you. And then to step out and say, I'm a deacon and a dad at the church, people are going to say, well, what kind of people go to that church? What kind of Christians are they that act that way? And that's the kind of scrutiny that we come under as Christians in the same way. So I want to use a little example this morning. Turn in your Bibles, if you will, to the Gospel of Mark chapter 9. And I want to look at just shortly, briefly this morning about how we need to be careful about what we say and do. And we'll use an example in the scriptures. And this is where, if you recall, it should be familiar to us. The Bible says, and he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, what was it that you disputed among yourselves by the way? Now, if you recall, and you want to go back later on today and look and read, they were kind of bickering back and forth about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom. And you can imagine that. Who of us, if not as parents, have not heard our kids arguing about something off at one end of the house and couldn't really understand what they were saying? And then later on said, by the way, what were you all fussing about in there? And that's pretty much what you can kind of get the picture of Jesus. Of course, we know Jesus knew what they were saying, but he wanted them to know that he knew that they were bickering about who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom. And that's what I want us to think about this morning, is the things that we say, the things that we look at, 5 reasons that we should be careful about our words and our actions. First is that all believers, we as believers, have to understand that we will be called into account someday for everything that we say and do. John chapter 5, verse 2 is that scripture. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son. All judgment unto the Son. We should judge ourselves. That's why, you know, we always should look at Jesus as the example to pattern ourselves, to follow after, and to try to mimic, if you will. It's because he himself is going to be the one that's going to be either, if as you've heard me say before in the past, he's either going to be the prosecuting attorney or he's going to be the defense attorney. And I certainly want Jesus as my defense attorney rather than the prosecuting attorney in this particular instance especially. And he left it for us. And that's why we say we have to be faithful as servants, living faithful until Christ returns or until we're called away in death. Have to strive to walk. Not saying that we're not going to make a mistake. Not saying we're not going to have a Kroger moment. Hopefully you never have a baseball park moment. But hopefully we understand that we're going to have those moments and to do the right thing. To do the right thing as a Christian. If you you have a Kroger moment, it would have made me feel really good if that guy would have walked across the parking lot over that guy and said, look, I'm sorry, I lost my temper, I shouldn't have acted that way. And that's what it's going to take for us as Christians to make a repair in an instance like that. We have to go the effort to make the repair. So we have to realize that we're going to be called into account by the Lord. And Jesus will be the judge. An idle word spoken, angry word spoken, ignorant word spoken, are all going to be held to our account. We need to remember that. Something else from Matthew chapter 17, right along those lines, our conversation, as I said. Matthew 12, verses 36 and 37. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account, therefore, in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So it's our conversation. It's what we say. It's not what we say in church. It's not what we say during a fellowship meal. We're on our best behavior, aren't we? We're going to make sure that we don't say anything that someone's going to call into question. But what about when we're not around anyone that we know at church? We may not guard ourselves so much. But God hears every word we say. And more importantly, He knows what's in our hearts. And He knows what comes from within the heart is out of what condemns a man, the Bible tells us. Not what we put in, it's what comes out of the mouth. So that's what we have to understand. Looking for good conversation. Have you ever thought about your conversations in that light? We should as Christians. Malachi chapter 3 verse 16 says this. And I don't have the 17th and 18th verse, I don't think, up there. But I'm going to go ahead and read that. Verse 16 starting says, then they that feared the Lord spake often one to the other, and the Lord hearkened and heard it, and a book of remembrance was written before Him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon His name. And they shall be mine, said the Lord of hosts, in that day when I make up my jewels, and I will spare them as a man spareth his own son that serveth him. Then shall you return and discern between the righteous and the wicked, between him that serveth God and him that serveth him not. So who's he having that conversation with, as God says that? Who's going to be the discerner of those that are servants of God and those that are not? It's Jesus. And that's what we have to recall. And good conversation is something that's pleasing to the Lord. He hears those conversations. And so that's what we have to understand. Oftentimes, who do we talk about the most? People we know, isn't it? Our friends, our family, and the people that we go to church with. That's who we talk about, because that's the most people that we observe, see what they do, and that sort of thing. But that's the most dangerous thing for us to do, because we're talking about a fellow brother or sister in Christ. And what did we just read out of Malachi? And what did we learn in the Gospels that we were reading there in John and in Mark? Jesus is going to take an account, and He died for them just the same as He died for us. And should we be talking about a fellow Christian who's covered by the same blood of Christ that's covering the sin of gossip that we're engaging in? We should remember that. Good godly conversation is pleasing to God, and that's what we should try to always engage in. Corrupt words, corrupt conversation, I think it would, though it doesn't say here, I think it would be safe to say that it's displeasing to God. And we have to be aware of that as well. So certainly, before we speak, it's always good to let your brain go in your ear before your tongue does. And think about what you're saying. And think about whom you're saying things about. And remember those things. We also have to remember, very much like in our scripture here, that we will be called into account over a dispute. Now, the disciples was disputing about who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom. Remember, that's what Jesus called them out on. But disputes, period, is what we have to remember. We have to handle disputes well as Christians also. A dispute, according to the dictionary, is a mutual contradiction with opposition stemming from it. I mean, you can disagree. Harold and I can disagree on something, but that doesn't mean that we're in a dispute over it. Now, if we have opposition on something, then we're disputing. And oftentimes, that's what we have to realize. Disputes are often opinions. And when you have a dispute over an opinion, that's usually related to a personal agenda, something that they want to see done. And that type of dispute really can never be settled justly. It can never be satisfied by both parties. It's always going to end up kind of an object of shame. There are going to be different interests, there are going to be different opinions, and there are going to be different passions about those things. And most of the time, other people don't share yours or will not take those on to have a satisfactory thing. Now, disputes over biblical things, about how to reach the lost or how best to serve your community, those can be changed when both people's hearts are following after what's best for the church and for God's service. Now, there is a difference. I don't want us to think that there's no hope. But we have to handle disputes well. That includes disputes in family matters, and we see that, and I've seen that before in the past, how disputes over certain items. Mommy said I could have that. Dad said that was mine. That tree's on my property. That tree's on the property line. Those types of things. We all have probably experienced that one way or another. And we all have probably also experienced a family member being hurt during one of those disputes and not speaking for years over things like that. Over things that really, in the grand scheme of things, matter about that much. And that's what we have to realize as Christians. Let us always be on the right side of disputes. Let us always, well, let me give you five little pointers here about how to handle a dispute. Of course, this one, the first one, before you get too excited, let me read the second one first. The first one is always be on the side of truth and right. Of course, anytime we're in a dispute, we're always on the side of truth and right, aren't we? But now point number two, realize you might be wrong. That's the hardest thing for us to do. We always believe that my side is the right side, and I know the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help me, Rob. But Rob could be wrong. And that's what we need to be aware of. And also have full control over yourself. Don't get so angry that you start to say things that you never would have said and you never would mean. It's always best to just walk away from an instance like that. Remember, you're a Christian and you have to observe, this is the fourth point, we have to observe proper love toward people. Because all of these items that we say that we're due, it's my right that I have that, who actually owns everything? God, I thought. So if you're going to battle for God on property rights, you better make sure that everything's in the right. And then remember, finally, in any kind of dispute, who's going to ultimately hold you to account on how you dealt with this? The Lord. The Lord's going to hold you to account. So you have to ask yourself, am what I'm fighting over and what I am disputing over and what I'm making statements over, is it worth me having to answer? How will I feel about answering to Jesus someday about how I handle this situation? And when we look at things in those lights, when we look at those kinds of situations and we realize, you know what, that's really small compared to the grand scope of things. As long as someone has it that will take care of it, sometimes it's the best answer. I never liked that tree anyway because I hate to rake leaves. You want to cut it down, it's yours. You know, we need to be aware of what we're saying and what we're doing, because we'll be dealt with, and this is the fourth point, over disputes, but especially when it comes to a dispute about supremacy. And that's what we see here with the disciples back in Mark chapter 9 again. You know, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom? That was their concern. Who would have the top spot? Who would be the top dog, top of the totem pole, number one in the pecking order in the kingdom of God? And I guess that's why Jesus called them out. Hey, what were you all fighting about anyway back there on the way up here? What are you carrying on about? Well, they didn't say a word. Well, we'll look at that here. Back in Mark chapter 9. Let me read 34 to kind of fill in. But they held their peace, didn't say nothing, clammed up, mumps the word. For by the way, they had disputed among themselves who should be the greatest. And in verse 35, and he sat down and called the 12 and saith unto them, if any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all. Jesus sets them straight right there, doesn't he? You're going to be the greatest in the kingdom, then that means you've got to be the greatest servant in the kingdom. That's kind of a contradiction of terms, isn't it? But that's exactly the pattern that Jesus taught us, wasn't it? I mean, what was it that Jesus said? You know, he came to do whose will? Not Jesus' will, but the will of him who sent him. What was one of the last acts at the upper room when they was gathering there for the Passover? Jesus' last Passover. Who washed whose feet, in other words? Jesus washed the disciples' feet. He was teaching them to be a great in the kingdom. You had to serve others before yourself. You had to make other people more important than yourself. And that's hard for us to do in our own eyes and minds. It's hard for me to put someone else's needs, desires, and wants ahead of my own because I'm selfish. I'm a human being. I want to make sure that I'm taken care of first, or if not myself, my family is taken care of first before I put the needs of someone else ahead of me. So it's something that we have to work on in order to accomplish. And you can imagine how disappointed Jesus was teaching them one thing and them thinking something completely different. What have we been teaching them? What have they been hearing, maybe he was saying? What are they thinking? Who's going to be the greatest of the kingdom? Well, it kind of indicates some things about that displeasure. First off, who's going to be the greatest? I'm going to be the greatest. No, Mom said I would be the greatest. Well, that's a mistaken notion about Jesus and what the kingdom is, isn't it? Not about ranking. Who's going to be the greatest? Who's going to sit on the right hand? Who's going to sit on the left? It's a myth. They just didn't understand at this point. And it's the opposite when you talk about humility and love. It's the opposite of that. And that's what we have to conduct ourselves like. And then, it's certainly contrary to the example that Jesus set. As I mentioned, I come to do the will of him who sent me. Not my will, but thy will. Those are the examples that Jesus set. Even to the point at the garden, whenever he was praying, and praying so hard that he was sweating blood, and he said, if it's possible, take this cup from me, but not my will, but thy will. He was even humble in that point, submissive to God and his will there. How many of us would demand that the cup be taken from us? How many of us do that on a daily basis when we're willing, or unwilling, I should say, to yield what we feel is due to us? It also goes against the growth of the church. And it makes us unfit for service. When we care more about ourselves than we care for other people, then we're not very likely going to go out and seek people to try to spread the good news of Jesus Christ to them. So, number one, that makes me unfit. I won't go out and do what I should be doing. And then we see that that kind of attitude is going to stifle the growth of the church. Because I'm more worried about Rob and what Rob wants than I am about what the church needs. would rather hold the church back and get my way as to see the church go forward and compromise on anything that I believe, anything that I feel is correct. Now, if that doesn't stifle growth, what will? If that's not contrary to what Jesus' message is about, what is? And that's what we have to understand. When we have a dispute over supremacy, my will is more important than God's will in this church because my great-great-great-great-grandpappy preached up here. Whenever I begin to think that way, it's time for me to get out of the way. And that's what we have to realize and understand. We will certainly be called, dealt with severely, if you will, when we believe that I am more supreme. My opinion, my desire is more supreme than the desire of God, Jesus. Paul wrote to the church of Philippi in Philippians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, and he said this, and here's what we need to be thinking about, kind of modeling our thoughts after these words, and they're going to be familiar words to you. He says, "Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus." And that's what we have to continue to do. When we yield ourselves to someone else's desires or the desires that are best for the church, we got to remember, I'm forgetting that's what desires were in the past. I'm pressing forward for that mark to serve in whatever way, whatever sacrifice I need to make, that the cause of Christ might be forwarded. Or we can draw ourselves back into the selfish shell and say, I don't care what happens. As long as I'm here, this is the way it's going to be. If we don't grow one person, that's fine. Now, that's the opposite of that. But that's happened so many times, it's scary. I'm not necessarily saying here, but I'm saying across our churches. But that's what the kind of an attitude we need to adopt is to press toward the mark. And Paul even says, I've not reached it yet. If you notice there, he says, I count myself not to have apprehended. He said, I'm not even married, but I'm still striving to get there. And that's what we have to do, because none of us are there yet. But we all should be reaching, striving, reaching out, trying to press toward that mark to reach that goal. And that's what should occupy us, staying focused on Jesus. Be careful about what we say. Be careful about what we do. It's important for us to always understand that people are watching us. But it's also the most important thing is to understand that God sees everything that we do. Whether it be in secret, in the privacy of our homes or our vehicles, or if it's in public, at a Kroger gas station parking lot, or a Lexington Legends baseball game. It's all visible. And we're always under scrutiny. Remember, we have to expect to be called into account by Jesus. We will give an account of our conversation. We will give an account over how well we handle disputes, and especially be severely dealt with, over disputes about supremacy. That's what the scripture shows. So I guess what it all boils down to is to ask yourself this question this morning. Are you pressing toward the mark? That's what Paul said. Are you pressing toward the mark? And then I want to ask this question. Whose mark are you pressing toward? Are you pressing toward the mark, that high calling of God through Jesus Christ, or are you pressing toward the mark of the high calling of Rob through selfish interest? You know what I'm saying? And that's what you have to decide. That's where kind of the old saying goes, the rubber meets the road. Now, if you've never accepted Christ, I want to encourage you to consider that this morning. Having heard and believed the gospel, having, or being willing rather, to repent of your sins and confess Christ as your Savior, be buried with him in the likeness of his death in baptism, receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit, and having the remission or forgiveness of sins in that, raise that new creation, come out, follow faithfully, serve faithfully until Christ returns or until we're called away in death. Now maybe you've done that. Maybe it was a year ago, maybe it was 10 years ago, maybe it was 50 years ago, and you realize today, just because I said something or read something, that you know what, I need to make a little change here. Well, I encourage you to do that as well. Because ultimately, it's between you and God. It's not between you and anybody in this room. Because our relationships with God through Jesus is personal. And just like any kind of personal relationship we have here on earth, the only way to make reparations is to go to that person and say, look. And that's the same way with God. Is to come to him and say, Lord, I've not been pressing toward the mark, but help me to get back there. In either case, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation this morning. Number 300.